Okay. Okay, so let's solve this last one. Let me connect my table here. Just a second. Okay, so the exercise it's for a press fit ensemble, and it says that we have a árbol escalonado. So when it says árbol escalonado, essentially it refers a shaft with shoulders, right, and a step shaft. Entonces luego también a la flecha le llaman árbol. So we have this shaft, and this one is going to go into a hoop. So like doing a
Sorry, teacher, how Christian, how do you know that is a press assemble?
Essentially, because the way the problem is talking about, because it's asking for this like interference o ajuste o el apriete máximo entre ellos, o sea, por la forma en la que está como redactado en sí.
Okay.
But essentially, whether it's an interference fit, then a press fit ensemble, it's based on the fit that we decide to choose, right? If we remember, we have different fits, so it's when we have this symbol or nomenclature that we talk about H11. C11. So based on this, we know if this is going to be a press or a loose fit. And essentially, this one, it's specified by the designer.
Okay.
Entonces, o sea, si vamos a utilizar un ajuste con holgura o un ajuste de interferencia, pues tendrá, o sea, ya en un problema de diseño, pues será especificado por el diseñador. En el ejercicio del examen se hablaba de diseñar una flecha para los elementos que se mostraban en la figura. Era la flecha EFG o algo así. Pues ahí cuando se diseña la flecha y que se tiene un engrane y se tienen los rodamientos, pues es directamente decisión del equipo de diseño definir si el engrane va a ser un engrane que se monte a presión o va a ser un engrane que se monte sin ningún problema con holgura. Entonces, ¿qué tolerancia se le va a dar? Pues se define la nomenclatura para la especificación de el ajuste y pues ya eso define si es con holgura o si es de presión. Si es de presión, la flecha y el engrane pues están montados a presión y ya sea que lo uno o lo otro transmiten la potencia, ¿no? O sea, si la potencia entra por el engrane, pues el engrane transmite la potencia a la flecha. Si la potencia entra por la flecha, pues la flecha transmite la potencia al engrane por el ajuste a presión sin que se necesita ningún otro elemento. Pero si se decide que el ajuste sea con holgura, se necesita poner un elemento para transmitir esa potencia, ya sea una cuña, un opresor, un pasador. Que si lo uno o lo otro, pues depende de las condiciones. Si el torque y potencia que se va a transmitir es muy elevado, la recomendación es que sean cuñas. Si no es tan elevado, podría ser un pasador. Si todavía es, pues, casi no se transmite potencia, nada más se quiere garantizar que permanezca en su posición, pues nada más un opresor. Entonces, pues van, o sea, las condiciones se van definiendo en función de lo que se necesita para la aplicación.
Ok, gracias, Cristian.
Ok. So essentially, we have the chat. And this one is going to go into the hoop. And says that the nominal dimension So this outside dimension in the hoop says that is 60 millimeters. And says that this distance is 80. So says that this shaft has 50 millimeters. that essentially is the same dimension, the basic diameter or the nominal diameter. And say that the length shaft is 130 millimeters. So here is talking about that the maximum tangential stress, so provides this condition, right? Maximum tangential stress, it's 60 megapascals. So that's the, like the requirement, because after reading the exercise that I have already read it like 3 or 4 times, there's no information about what is the specific feet that we are going to use. There are no indication about the nomenclature. So looking for information about what type of feet it is, the only information that we have in this case, it's like a limitation or a specification about the maximum tangential stress. Actually, it says that is lame. And it's this value. So then we need to define, based on this condition, what is going to be all these different questions. Entonces, o sea, ya después de haber leído como 3-4 veces el ejercicio no nos dice cuál es el tipo de ajuste específico, que creo que era lo que me preguntaba hace un momento también, Sara, ¿no? Entonces no nos dice específicamente cuál es la condición donde sabemos que va a ser un ajuste de presión es, bueno, mencionaba yo que por acá abajo nos decía del apriete máximo, pero ese apriete está especificado para esta condición de esfuerzo tangencial. So, I don't know if you already reach at the following conclusion, but essentially we will need to look at the Lame equations, and from these Lame equations we are going to find the pressure, because we already have the stress, one of these. In a moment we define which of these stresses do we have, but we are going to know the stress, pressure stress, and we know the diameters. So we will be able to determine the pressure. And once we determine the pressure, we can continue with the solution. Do you got it, that one? Do you have a question?
No, Christian.
Bueno, lo que estoy diciendo es que la condición que tenemos es que cuando se realice el ensamble, nos dice que el máximo esfuerzo tangencial es 60 megapascales, entre paréntesis nos indica que es Lame, entonces debe ser con las ecuaciones de Lame. Entonces esta es la condición. Entonces ese esfuerzo tangencial corresponde a un esfuerzo tangencial de los diferentes componentes que podemos tener aquí, o corresponde a uno de estos específicos, y entonces con ese esfuerzo tangencial y los diámetros que los conocemos, vamos a poder conocer la presión. Entonces el primer paso es conocer la presión. Déjame cerrar aquí un archivo. No sé si en realidad el problema no era el del español o el inglés, y si sí se entendió o no.
No, sí, un poco mejor.
So, so when it says so, esfuerzo tangencial entre la flecha y el cubo. So, essentially is tangential stress. So we mentioned that we have stress between the chaff and the hoop. So what component is talking about?
What was the question, Christian?
When we say that the problem, or when the problem says esfuerzo tangencial entre la flecha y el cubo, tangential stress between the chaff and the hoop, so it corresponds to a specific stress component. This stress component, based on these figures, which one it is?
The letter B, the second one.
I think that, well, actually, should be this one. In this position.
Yes.
At any position inside the hook, that actually it's this same position, it's, or is the interface with the chaff, so it's like this one. Let's look at those components in the Lamé equation. Okay, so if we, this is the tangential stress between the hoop and the chaff, And this is the tangential stress between the chaff and the hoop. The value is going to be the same. The only difference is that this one is positive and this one is negative. So essentially in the hoop, we are going to have that is tension, and in the chaff, we are going to have that is compression, but it's the same value. So essentially the data that the exercise is providing is that one. It's saying that this tangential stress, let's say it, between the core and the outside, that one is going to be 60 megapascals. Do you agree with that?
Yes.
So essentially this is the condition that will allow to solve the problem, because then it's going to be this equation, or can be the other, but let's use this one that is positive. We would like to stay positive in our lives. So it's this one. So essentially, in this equation, let's remember that if I'm correct, you can verify it. The outside diameter, it's this one, DO. The core diameter is this one, DC. And that's all. So essentially, the pressure well, we can just make the operations that are in between the parentheses, and then we leave alone the pressure. So it's here the 60 megapascals, which is going to be equal to the pressure and the operation. So it's going to be 60. And this square plus the one in the core, that is 15. Square. Megapascals is the same as working with newtons over square millimeters. So it's good that I'm working with millimeters for the diameters. Over the outside, that is 60. I won't write me. I know that is millimeters. Minus the core, that is 50. Square. So it's 60 megapascals. The pressure and all this operation, how much it gives? Let me see how much it's 60 square minus 50 square. And this is over, and let's open a parenthesis, 60 square minus 50 square, we close. And so essentially it's going to be one, right?
Outside. The value of parentheses is 5.54.
I got a value of one actually. And like,
have you got 5.54?
Yes, 5.54.
5.54?
Yes.
Yes.
Only the parentheses.
In the operation, use the square root, no? Not the potential.
I think it is the potential, right? Because it's a square.
Sí, está elevado al cuadrado.
Okay. Well, I got 5.54.
Me too.
Yo tuve uno. Yo obtuve uno.
Yo también tuve 5.54.
O sea que me equivoqué. Let's check one condition here. Okay. Okay. Entonces obtuvieron
5.54. Yes.
Sí.
And the value of PC is 10.81.
Okay. This is square millimeters. So this PC is going to be how much?
10.81.
And these are this is dimensionless, right? Because it's a square millimeters in the numerator and the same in the denominator, so actually it's dimensionless. Es adimensional, ¿no? Porque tenemos milímetros arriba y milímetros abajo, o sea, es 5.54 nada más, es un factor.
Okay.
So this one is megapascals, actually. So this is the pressure. So with that pressure, we can calculate calculate the interference, letter A. Do you agree with that?
Yes.
Just let's see if it's the same material for both, the chap and the hoop. So it's the same material? I think yes, right? Because it says that the elasticity and Poisson's ratio, it's this value. Yeah, so it says same material. So we can use this second equation. Es el mismo material entre la flecha, de la flecha y el cubo. Entonces podemos utilizar la versión reducida de la presión cuando es el mismo material, porque es el mismo módulo de elasticidad y relación de Poisson. So this is for letter A. The pressure is going to be 10.81 megapascals. And this one is going to be the interference. The elastic modulus, it says that is 208 gigapascals. 206.8. So it's 206.8. But this one is gigapascals and we have megapascals. So let's say that it is this one times 10 to the 3 megapascals. And then the relations between the diameters. So the diameter at the core, it's 50. Square minus the diameter at the inside. So this one is going to be zero because the shaft, the problem says that it's solid. So this shaft is completely solid. So we don't have inside diameter in the shaft, so it's going to be zero, that and this one. So then here is only the 50. Times the outside diameter, that is going to be 60. Minus the core, 50. This operation as well is square millimeters. And here is 2 times the diameter at the core. So that one is going to be 50. This is to the cubic. And at the outside is 60. So it's 10.81. Megapascals. The interference, and it's all these operations. If we look at the units, these megapascals will cancel out, right? And this square is going to cancel with this one. And this other square is going to cancel with 2 of these. So at the end, we are going to have that. We have millimeters in the denominator here that goes to the other side in the numerator. So the units are going to be okay. We're going to have units of millimeters. So all these operations, what factor provides?
Zero point six hundred and thirty-one,
1/mm. So this interference, and this already canceled as well. Well. So the interference is going to be 10.81 times this one. I know it's divided. Are you sure that gives this value?
I've got 631.
You say me 0.631, Alejandro, or just 631?
Yes, but I have just seen that the last signal is times 10 or to the three, yes.
So it's should be this one, 631, right? I think. Because it's going to be this over this, and it's a small quantity. Pick a small quantity for the interference. So it's 631.
Yes.
So it's 10.81 over 631. So how much is that one?
Point 0.017.
So this is the interferencia o el apriete máximo. And essentially for the other, we need just to continue applying the corresponding equations. We already have the pressure, we have the interference, we have the diameters. So essentially it's just using the equations for the maximum axial force that we need to do the assemble. It's going to be, I think that this last equation works. So for B, so that axial force is going to be the friction. Says that is 0.2. The pressure, so that pressure, it's the 10.81. This is Newton over square millimeters. Then P. The diameter at the core, that is 50. And the length. So this length is going to be the length of the hoop. So it's the 80 millimeters. And it's going to be the length of the hoop because essentially it's the length that we need to displace. Pues es la longitud que necesitamos mover. Si exactamente nada más entra a los 80 milímetros, pues son 80 milímetros. O si tiene que entrar 85, pues 85. O sea, es la distancia que se tendría que desplazar para hacer el ajuste. So how much is going to be this one? So this millimeters cancels out.
I got 1167.7.
Yeah, me too. 0.49.
Ah, yes.
Okay, so these are newtons. And so we need to continue applying the corresponding equations. So I don't know if you have some questions so far.
Teacher, can you please explain again in el inciso A? Why was that diameter zero?
Yes, because the problem says that the shaft, it's circular section, but it's completely solid circular section. So that means that the shaft,
there is no diameter.
There is no hole here, right?
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
So the questions, all the questions consider the possibility that the shaft is hollow. O sea, todas las ecuaciones consideran la posibilidad de que la flecha sea hueca, pero donde la flecha no es hueca, el diámetro interior pues es cero.
Okay. Thank you.
Pues, si quieren, continuamos mañana. Uh-huh.
Okay, teacher. Christian, gracias. Thank you.
Gracias. Nos vemos mañana.
Gracias.